Since the beginning of the video game industry, some parents have worried that their kids spend too much time playing video games. Those concerns really took off in the late 80s, when the Nintendo Entertainment System exploded in popularity. By 1989, 20% of American households owned an NES. Nintendo controlled about 80% of the market, with $1.7 billion in revenue. Kids couldn't get enough, and that scared some parents. They worried about their children's social skill development, and that the video games were eating up time that could have been spent on homework, or playing outside, or socializing with friends face-to-face. Nintendo didn't offer up many solutions. Instead, they drafted a bland statement that encouraged moderation. But one eclectic inventor thought he had a better idea, and made what is perhaps the video game industry's first parental control device. It was called Homework First, and it was a literal lock for the Nintendo Entertainment System. Marketed as a time management tool, Homework First prevented users from inserting cartridges into the console. It's basically a chastity belt for your NES. The mastermind behind the lock was Thomas Lowe. He formed his company, SafeCare Products, in his Chicago basement back in 1987. Inventing consumer goods ran in the Lowe family. Thomas's father, Edward Lowe, invented kitty litter. SafeCare Products made all sorts of items: childproof appliance plug locks, inflatable bath cushions, storage solutions for your video games. Their most popular product was What a Catch, a Velcro football and glove set. Lowe was always on the lookout for new ideas, and inspiration struck one night while Lowe talked with a friend. The friend complained that his 14-year-old son had been up past midnight playing Nintendo. The friend wished there was some way to lock up the NES. Well, that was all Lowe needed to hear. He got to work and came up with a few ideas, but ultimately settled on what one reporter later described as a souped-up bike lock. It's an accurate description. Lowe nauseatingly named his device Homework First. The lock features a master lock mechanism along with a U-bolt. The top of the lock features what looks like a red button, but it's just a piece of plastic for aesthetic purposes. On the back of the packaging, SafeCare Products made their pitch. As evidenced by the many nationally published articles, video games are causing much concern for parents and educators. Now you can do something about it. Before you attach the lock, make sure there are no cartridges in the system. Otherwise, it defeats the purpose. To connect Homework First, you have to set the dials to your combination. Now you can detach the U-bolt from the lock. The bolt hooks into a screw hole on the bottom of the NES. Then you put the lock back on, spin the combination dials, and done. The NES is now locked. In an attempt to appeal to gamers, Lowe noted that the lock could keep anyone in a family from erasing a saved game during a break in the action. Now, when your little brother or sister tries to play Star Tropics, they won't be able to overwrite your save file. In fact, they won't be able to play the game at all. I have had family members erase my game saves accidentally, but this seems like an extreme solution to the problem. Actually, this whole idea seems like a radical solution. When I was a kid, my parents just took the system away when we got in trouble. My friend's parents would hide the power supply. I can't even imagine my mom slapping a literal lock on my video game console. Guns? Sure. Liquor? Makes sense. But my NES? Homework First made its public debut at the 1989 Summer Consumer Electronics Show in Chicago, Illinois. News of the lock went international. British video game magazine Ace called it a party-pooping add-on that most Nintendo maniacs wouldn't want to see in a mile of their machines. French magazine Joystick Hebdo proclaimed it a demonic lock. But parent advocates were thrilled, claiming, "At last, there's a product that puts the Nintendo control stick where it belongs, in a parent's hands." Lowe argued that the lock was a time management tool. It gives parents a simple and effective way to manage video game playing without threats or more severe forms of punishment. But some parents and psychologists thought the lock wasn't the best way to deal with video game addiction. Dr. Carl Johnson, a child development psychologist, suggested parents should compromise on playtime rather than laying down the law. One parent took it to an extreme, writing, "What, on the other hand, does the homework first lock teach? That you can do pretty much whatever you want as long as there isn't something, a lock, a wall, a moat, an electronic surveillance system, stopping you." By the end of 1989, Homework First was available nationally in stores such as KB Toys, Walmart, Toys R Us, and even mail order magazines like Sharper Image. It retailed for around $20. But did Homework First become a massive hit for safe care products? Not really. By July of 1990, less than a year after its release, Lowe claimed he sold about 30,000 units. According to the patent documents, Lowe had other ideas, including a dust cover for the cartridge slot and a turnkey lock. But these devices never came to fruition. Surprisingly, Lowe wasn't the only one to come up with a lock for video game consoles. In 1991, a small startup called Niche Technology announced the Timeout Lock, which blocked the cartridge slot on both Nintendo and Sega consoles. However, I haven't been able to find any evidence this product was ever released. By 1995, Thomas Lowe had dissolved Safe Care Products and moved on to new ventures. Today, he runs Round 2 Corp, a company that reproduces old die-cast model toy cars. Parental controls are a standard feature on modern consoles, and developers incorporate them into the system software. But it's interesting to see what lengths parents went to back in the day to curb their kids' video game playtime. Homework First was a solution to a problem that already had better solutions. Honestly, I think its best use is to lock a game into the console. Forever cursing someone to play one game on their NES for the rest of their lives. That's all for this episode of The Gaming Historian. Thanks for watching.
Funding for Gaming Historian is provided in part by supporters on Patreon. Thank you.